Okay, thank you, Peter, for the introduction, and it's a great honor to be here giving this lecture, so thanks everyone for coming. And I'm going to talk about secure multi-party computation. This is a pretty big and increasingly popular research area in cryptography. My research in this area dates back to the days of my PhD, I guess late 1990s. At the time, it was considered pure science fiction, but today I get the sense that there is a lot of genuine interest in this problem, also in the more applied side, both in the industry and academia. So, coming from the theory side, my talk will mainly be about the theory, but I will try to also reflect as accurately as I can some applied issues. Needless to say, coming from the theory side, everything I say about the real world should be taken with a grain of salt, or better yet, just think of it as a metaphor. But if you have any objections or questions, feel free to ask. Okay, so. Great, so. Good, so people have been talking about the paperless office, I guess, for ages since I was born, and I don't know to what extent this is true. I guess we can ask the rate for it. But something that's less controversial is that more and more of our life and our important information is going digital. So things that used to have be entirely on paper or also have paper backups are now switching to a digital form, and we have huge amounts of data that is only in digital form. Some of it is very important, sensitive, and sometimes expensive. Okay, so what do we do when we have important digital information? Well, how do we keep it intact? Right? So, like everything, we put
it
in our phone.
Your microphone is off.
Oh, okay. Sorry. Yeah. Okay. Thanks. Okay, so like everything, we put important data on my phone. This is a screenshot from my actual phone. Not sure how important this data is, but it was on my phone. Okay, but I guess that most of us have experienced at least once in our lives that having this single point of failure makes things actually fail. Right, so I guess that most of us have lost some information that we didn't back up, and since then we learn, most of us learn to back up information. And if you want to be careful, you can now have all these, you know, mostly free cloud providers that are nice enough to offer storage services. And, you know, if you want to be on the safe side, maybe slightly on the paranoid side, you employ multiple such cloud servers, you know, owned by different companies, one from China, one from Russia, you know, to be on the safe side. And if you're even more paranoid, you also have a USB stick backup and use, you know, an old PC that hackers don't know how to hack. And finally, also print out a physical copy, put it in a, you know, in a file cabinet, and put it in grandma's basin and ask her not to let anyone near it. Okay, so if we've done all these measures now, you know, barring a zombie apocalypse, our data is indestructible. Nobody will be able to destroy our data. Okay, so, and, you know, we can even do it using far less storage than replicating our data everywhere, and this has been the theme of doing it efficiently, the theme of a rich and beautiful theory on error correcting codes. Okay, so great. So we can efficiently, we know how to make our data available. But now what about confidentiality? What about the possibility that our data might leak? So note that putting all these copies of our data on the cloud only makes us more vulnerable, increases the attack surface, and makes each and every one of these cloud servers a single point of failure, right? And, you know, as history shows us again and again, when it's sufficiently lucrative, then, you know, servers do get hacked, or accounts do get hacked. This was a high profile. This is a real tweet by this celebrity. There was, about 5 years ago, quite a few iCloud accounts of celebrities have been hacked, and photos, some of which are sensitive, have been stolen. Okay, so it is a very good backup, so all these photos will remain on the internet forever, but it's not very good. It's not very good for the, from the confidentiality point of view. Okay, so one natural solution is to employ encryption. So let's take heavy-duty encryption key with 256 keys, store the key on our phone, or maybe back it up so that we don't lose it. And this is good. It would have probably prevented this iCloud fiasco had the data been encrypted. It's still not super safe, because now if someone gets access both to the key and to the encrypted data, they have the data. But of course, it's better than doing nothing. And perhaps an even better solution is to use secret sharing. What is secret sharing? Secret sharing is a randomized way of splitting data into two or more pieces, such that if somebody has access to few pieces, they learn nothing about the data, and if they have all or most of the pieces, they can recover the data. Okay, so you can think of it as the analog of error correcting codes, but for secrecy or confidentiality instead of integrity. Okay, so a simple way of sharing a secret into two pieces is to pick one piece as a random string of the same length of x, and the other piece will be the data x XORed with r. And it's easy to see that no matter what x is, this is uniformly random. This is the principle behind the one-time paired encryption. Okay, so now if somebody hacks either Dropbox or Google Drive accounts, they learn nothing, or more accurately, they only learn an upper bound on the length of our data, which is something that must be leaked. Good, and we can generalize this to, now we can even remove the data from our phone. I mean, one of the reasons that we back data up is that we don't want to store, we cannot store all of it locally, right? So we also use these clouds to store stuff we can't store on our own. Okay, and you can generalize this to 7 out of 7 secret sharing. So you pick the first 6 strings at random, and then you mask the data with all of them. And you can see that this is uniformly distributed among all 7 tuples of strings whose exclusive OR is X. Okay, so this is N out of N secret sharing. You can generalize it. This will be useful in what follows to any finite group. We will typically let groups be a billion by default. So again, you pick the first 6 shares as random group element, and the rest is what you need so that all shares add up to the data X. Okay, and we will refer to this as additive secret sharing of X over the group G. Okay, this is a more symmetric view. And after we've done it, our data is virtually unleakable, and we can even combine confidentiality with integrity by using fancier secret sharing schemes, such as Shamir's scheme, which uses a random polynomial in which the data X is a free coefficient to split a secret in a way that up to T shares reveal nothing about the secret, and if you have at least T shares, then you can recover the secret, right? Because each share will be the evaluation of a random degree T polynomial with X as a free coefficient on a distinct point. And you can show that this has the property that up to T shares reveal nothing, and more than T shares allow us to interpolate. Okay, so this can combine both secrecy and integrity. Great, so now we can be pretty happy about our data being securely stored. But now what about functionality, right? Can we make use of the data, right? So what do we do with our data? A common thing to do with our data is search it, right? We want to pull something specific. So in this example, let's say that we store our photos on the cloud using secret sharing. So for now, let's go back to the simple additive secret sharing for simplicity. Forget about integrity. For now, we only care about confidentiality. So we split it into additive shares, and we have another picture and another picture, so they're all being secret shared among these 7 cloud servers. Okay, now what? Suppose that we want to run some searching algorithm, right? By now, there are clever searching algorithms that can even search our photos. Let's say that we want to find the picture that has the cover of Vogue magazine, right? The previous picture. Well, how do we do it, right? Each server locally just sees junk. Okay, so how do you propose to do it? Well, the natural approach is to pull the data in a single place. Let's say that you don't want to download all of it on the phone, but here they have fast communication lines, so they can bring it all to Google. Google will recover the data and find the right match. Okay, so that's a way of solving the problem, but obviously it now makes Google again a single point of failure. Now, you might say, well, we do trust Google with our photos, right? Most of us do, I do. Okay, but what about our email? Okay, we also trust, okay, not a good example. But maybe if we had really sensitive emails, we would not want to keep them with Gmail. I mean, Gmail accounts have been and will be hacked. Maybe we don't want this single point. Well, maybe I'm fine with my emails being on Gmail, but if I had very sensitive emails, they would not be on Gmail. Do you listen, hackers? I don't have sensitive emails. right, and when you look at financial data, I don't know, I guess that fewer of us would be willing to store all of our financial history at Google, and even fewer would be willing to store all of our health data with Google. Okay, so having this single point of failure just, you know, especially when the data is lucrative or sensitive, this calls for accounts being hacked and creates a single point of failure that will actually be materialized in the real world, in many cases. Okay, so what do we do? Well, MPC, Secure Multi-Party Computation, which is abbreviated as MPC, provides a decentralized alternative in which it has this magical property. It's a protocol that allows the servers to talk with each other, right, so they interact. And in the end of this interaction, they get these secret shares of the output, right? So this is, should I see a doctor, is basically invoking some learning algorithm that scans my data, my health data, and search for some suspicious pattern that signals that I should see a doctor, right? So this secure protocol, via interaction, it has the property that, you know, these shares are a succinct secret share, right? These are short shares that just encode a single bit node. They can be one bit each. Yet the interaction does not reveal, even to subset of participating parties, any information about my data. Not even the output, because the output is in a secret shared format. Okay, so this is the property. It sounds like a magical property. You can think of it as computing on secret shared or encrypted data without ever reconstructing it. Okay, so this is the property of an MPC protocol, and it's even more useful when combining data that comes from multiple sources. So each source can split its data between different servers. They might trust different servers, or it might even locally hold the data. And there are many, many situations in the real world where we have huge inefficiencies because different parties, like hospitals or banks, are either unwilling or unable for legal reasons to share their data and do data mining on their data. So today, in many cases, we don't mine or we don't do analysis of data from multiple sources because the data is sensitive and there are no mechanisms for enabling this collaboration without introducing a single point of failure. So the goal of secure multi-party computation is to have this mechanism for computing on distributed data. Distributed can mean that each holds a different piece of data or that we hold secret shares of data without introducing a single point of failure. Okay, that's an informal view of what MPC is about. Okay, so it will get much more precise than that, but if there is any high-level question, this is a good time to ask. Okay. Good. So rest of talk, I'll start with a simple and very concrete example to make things as concrete as possible. Then I will talk about defining MPC, which is quite tricky. I will give you some overview of how we solve general computations using MPC in different settings. And the talk will contain quite a few open questions. And also, I guess, we'll clarify why we will never run of open questions in this area. You can say it about any area, but I think specifically about this area. So let me start by explaining the last comment, why we will never run of open problems. Well, MPC is much more general problem. It's in its general formulation, it's much more general than the previous examples indicate. It's not just that we can. There are formulations of MPC that can be used to capture problems for many other domains as instances of the general problem. So in a sense, it inherits the non-triviality or depth from these other problems. And it also means that progress in these other domains, specific domains sometimes, in many cases helps MPC. So MPC is kind of a problem that sometimes has a life of its own, and sometimes it's closely, some special cases of it are closely related to questions that were asked by others, by other communities, and we will see some examples of that. Okay, it's just a very general problem. But the rest of this talk, I will, so this is why MPC is too big for fail. If you hope it will die, I'm afraid it will not happen soon. However, in the rest of the talk, we will not shoot for a level of generality that captures all these things in special cases, and we will focus on the more straightforward goal of computing a function on multiple inputs. Okay, so forget about this generality. It will not be reflected in most of what I will talk about. Okay, so let's start by asking the following question. I'm really curious how much we earn. Let's exclude the students and postdocs and the... I want to find the average salary of the other people in the room, and let's say that there are six of them. So the goal, right, we know that there are six participants here, so the goal is to compute the sum. If we can compute the sum, we can compute the average. It's equivalent, right? We divide by six. And our goal is not to reveal, right, salaries are confidential for most of us, and we don't want to reveal our salaries. Sometimes we're not allowed to reveal our salaries, yet we want to learn the sum of all salaries. Okay, so one solution is to employ some trusted party, someone we all love and trust. Use a secure email to send our inputs. In this case, we will also not lie about our inputs. Right, so I assume that parties are truthful in reporting their correct input. And the trusted party computes the sum and announces it to everyone. Okay, so this does achieve the goal in case we can find someone that we all trust. But even if we can find someone we can all trust, there's always this lingering doubt that maybe, the untimely death of party five was not a result of unfortunate accident, and maybe it had something to do with the extra income. We never know. So let's look for a different solution. So the different solution is via an MPC protocol that only involves the parties themselves without the trusted party. So this is probably the simplest, one of the simplest useful examples of MPC. You can actually run it in class and it works. So what do we do? Well, let me assume this is adjusted to the Bay Area. Normally it's 10 to the 10. So let's assume that all salaries are bounded by 10 to the 10. And now we can compute the sum modulo m, okay, modulo this upper bound, and we know that it will be equal to the actual sum over the integers. Okay, so all operations, when I say addition and plus and minus, are carried out in the group of integers modulo m. Okay, so now the first party tosses some coins and picks a secret random element in Zm. Okay, what does he do? He adds this randomness as a mask to the input and sends the result as a message to the second party. Okay, so the first party is the salary of P1. The first message is the salary of P1 plus his secret randomness. Okay, as we said before, this is like a one-time pad, so the second party learns absolutely nothing about the salary of the first party. What does the second party do? Add to the message he received his own input, right? And this again doesn't reveal anything to P3 because the sum, now we have the sum of the first two inputs masked with the same randomness, right? And we can go on and on, and in the end, the first party gets back a message which is equal to the sum, the output, plus his own randomness, which he can subtract and recover the output. Okay, so that's a protocol, and I hope I convinced you that each individual party doesn't learn anything beyond the output from the messages they messages they receive in the protocol. They receive two messages, most of them. One from the previous party, and another one is the final output. Okay, so this is the final output which is being announced. Okay, and I guess that some of you realize that there is a bit of a security issue here. What's a security issue? While each individual party does not learn anything from the communication, if two parties collude, they can easily figure out the input of the party between them, or the sum of inputs of all parties between them, right? If you take the first and the third party, you can subtract this second message received from P2 minus the message sent out by P1. So this is definitely that if P1 and P3 collude, they can do. They completely determine the output of P2. Okay, and note that this is something that we can hope to prevent. We cannot prevent colluding parties from learning the sum of all parties. This is something that is inevitable if we want to make the sum of everyone public, but certainly we can hope to prevent P1 and P3 from learning the input of P2. Okay, so that's some limitation which we can avoid by having a different version of the protocol. So this version uses quadratic communication in the number of parties, and it goes in the following way. So first take a complete graph and orient the edges arbitrarily. So now it's some tournament graph. And now for each directed edge, the party from whom the edge originates picks a random group element and sends it to the party to which the edge directs. Okay, so we have these independent random group elements that are generated for each edge. They're being sent in the direction of the edge. Okay, so this is the first round of interaction. And now in the second round of interaction, what do the parties do? Well, each party takes its own input, adds all incoming messages, and subtracts all outgoing messages, and sends this group element to everyone. And now it's easy to see in terms of correctness that if you add up all messages of the second round, then each edge cancels out, right? It appears in plus sign in the summation of one party and in minus sign in the summation of another party. So all we're left with is the sum of all inputs. So this shows how to recover the output. And it's not very difficult to prove that this protocol is as secure as it can be. Again, now for now we're considering parties that follow the protocol. So we just look at the information that a set of parties can learn. So it's not hard to prove that any set of parties, all they learn from this protocol is the sum of the inputs of the other parties. More generally, if you consider a general graph and ignore the edge directions, if you ask what information does a set of parties learn, you just look at the connected components of the graph after you remove the nodes, the corrupted nodes. And what the adversary learns is the sum of the inputs in each connected component. So a click cannot be disconnected, and as a special case, this means that this protocol is secure against any set of parties. Good. So you can already see some trade-off. This protocol is more secure, but also is less efficient, and you can prove that for this notion of security, this is the best one can do. You can do better in terms of communication. You can do better if you slightly relax security, but for this notion of security that's achieved by this protocol, this is the best one can do. Okay, so this is a very specific instance of secure computation for a specific function. I did not talk about parties that deviate from the protocol. I was assuming that everybody follows the protocol, but we can already see some interesting phenomena. Good, so more generally, we can ask a similar question for a different function f, a general function f. We can consider a general threshold T on the number of parties that can collude, and we want that any T parties, we learn nothing about the output, or we can consider learning a little bit of information, a negligible amount of information, which we typically allow in cryptography. And we refer to this as a secure MPC protocol for the function F. And now there are two questions one can ask. First of all is, when is this possible? For what functions, for what values of t is this possible? And the second is, how efficiently? Okay, so spoilers, let me give you the feasibility results from the 1980s that essentially answer these, at least the first question. So the first question tells us we know the following. So if we insist on information theoretic security, so the parties are computationally unbounded and we look at the information they can learn, in this case, we can solve the problem for every function if and only if we have an honest majority. By this I mean that if we have an honest majority, then all functions can be computed, and if we don't, then some functions cannot be computed. On the other hand, if we relax the notion of security to computational security, like standard encryption schemes, so it's security against computationally bounded attackers, then we can get better security against any strict subset of the parties under standard cryptographic assumptions. Okay, and the same, and these thresholds hold even for variations of the model. I will talk about different variations of the model. For instance, even if you allow parties to misbehave and not follow the protocol, still these results hold in a way that will be defined. Okay, but this gives us the general landscape of feasibility results in secure computation. In the information theoretic setting, we need an honest majority. In the computational setting, we can do without it. Good. The second question, which is really a subject of a huge amount of research in recent years, is about efficiency. And efficiency can be measured in at least three ways. Communication, how many bits are exchanged, rounds, how many times do people talk, and computation, what is the computational complexity, say in the circuit model or RAM model or whatever your computational model is. You can ask all these questions. What is the overhead of secure computation? You can ask this question from an asymptotic point of view or from a concrete point of view. And I should say that one nice thing working in this area is that there are very few situations in which you are in a dilemma. Say that you want to improve concrete efficiency of protocols. Typically, protocols that you cannot prove secure, suppose that you have some great idea to make things more efficient and you're not sure that it's secure. So typically in this domain, problems that you cannot prove secure, you can actually break them. Okay, so there is a relatively small gap between, provable guarantees and what we cannot break. Good. So in recent years, as I said, the world and also applied research communities are getting more and more interested in this problem. This interest is motivated by a huge amount of application scenarios, right? Essentially any problem that involves collaboration with sensitive data, MPC is relevant. There is a lot of development and even startup companies and even big companies like IBM, Google, VMware, Microsoft are all involved in some way in MPC. If you want a cool gadget that you can look online, there is a company called Calctopia that has an MPC spreadsheet. So you can have something like Excel, where each party can owns different cells in the spreadsheet, and you can actually do MPC in this interface. And all this more applied interest gives more motivation to study efficiency of MPC. So if in the 80s people declared the problem solved, today we're much more greedy in terms of requirements. People study both a general MPC compilers that take, say, a general circuit, or MPC for specific useful instances like set intersection, right? A very common practical problem. Ideally, we want no overhead, right? Or we want very little overhead. We want secure computation to be as efficient as a solution involving a trusted party. That's the ideal goal. We're very, very far from this goal, depending on the setting, several orders of magnitude typically. But in some settings, we're getting close, and more importantly, there are no fundamental barriers, and I believe that we keep discovering new and new techniques that reduce the overhead of secure computation, and hopefully in the future, things will get even better. Okay, so let me switch to talk about definitions. I'll try to be brief, but I should say that defining secure computation, especially in the presence of malicious or active adversaries, is a tricky task, in part because you cannot have a grocery list of requirements. Security is a complicated combination. Correctness and privacy interact in complex ways when parties can be malicious. What does it mean? What is my input? If I don't follow the protocol, what does it even mean? Right, so there's been a lot of effort in the crypto community that can be traced back to the work of Goldwasser and Mikali on defining semantically secure encryption via the works on zero-knowledge proofs. And all these works culminated in a good definitions that we now have, that we now agree on how to define security for MPC protocols. And at a high level, what these definitions say, they say, we will not tell you what are the exact properties of the protocol, but we will just say that this protocol is as secure as an ideal implementation that uses a trusted party. So if the adversary corrupting a set of parties can do something or learn something in the ideal model, then we also allow it in the protocol. But we also require the converse direction. Anything that the adversary can achieve by attacking the protocol, it could have also achieved by attacking an ideal implementation. Why can the adversary achieve things when attacking ideal implementation? Just because it is allowed to choose the inputs of corrupted parties and observe their outputs. So this gives the adversary both influence on the outputs of uncorrupted parties and knowledge, partial knowledge about their inputs. So this is what this definition says. By achieve, it means both information learned by the adversary and influence of the adversary and the outputs. And this captures a combination of secrecy, correctness, independence of inputs, and many properties. So the sum is bigger, the whole is bigger than its parts here. So you can formalize each of these properties separately, but we consider them jointly. And the way we do it is by considering these two worlds. One is the real world in which there is an adversary. I don't know how many of you know this person. This is a famous Israeli parapsychologist who claims to have mystical powers, right? Like Ben Spoon's using paranormal skills. So the adversary claims, hey, the adversary, think of it as a hacker who likes to brag. He says, hey, I can break this protocol. You know, this protocol is not secure enough for me. I can break it. And he has this skeptical friend, this is like a famous skeptic, who basically says, anything you can do, he says, you know, you can't break this protocol. Anything you can do, I can do by attacking the ideal implementation. Okay, so he's only interacting with a trusted party computing the function. And he's interacting with the actual honest parties. And security means that if the adversary can learn something about, say, the second uncorrupted party, then the simulator can learn the same with the same success probability by corrupting the same party. So if the adversary can do something, the simulator can do as well. And this also captures the influence on the outputs of the honest parties. So to formalize this, achieve the same property, we have this notion called an environment. And the environment is like a referee that tries to distinguish between the real adversary interacting with the honest parties via the real protocol and the simulator interacting with an ideal functionality via the ideal protocol. So the environment can send inputs to the adversary and to the honest parties. It receives outputs from the honest parties, and it can also tell the adversary instructions like, hey, try to corrupt this party and see what happens. And the protocol is secure. And the output of these two experiments is just the output that so it's a concatenation of what the adversary sends to the environment, which without loss of generality, it's everything the adversary can see when interacting with the honest party. This captures the full knowledge of the adversary and only the output of the honest parties, okay, which captures the influence that the adversary has on the output. and the same in the ideal world. And the protocol is secure, securely realizes F if for every adversary there is a simulator with comparable powers. We typically require that they have comparable computational power, such that no environment can distinguish between the adversary interacting with the real protocol and the simulator interacting with the ideal protocol. So the simulator, in a sense, can make up everything that the adversary can see and ensure that not only this alone is indistinguishable from the real experiment, but also when considered jointly with the outputs of the honest parties. Okay, so it's a bit complicated to digest, but the nice thing about this definition is that it automatically guarantees composition. And we have two flavors of the definition, one in which the environment, this is the classical notion of MPC in the old papers. Basically, it's not formulated in the same way, but it basically means that the environment can interact in the beginning, so it can send inputs to parties, and in the end, it gets the outputs of the honest parties and the views, but it cannot challenge interactively the adversary. And this notion of security is called standalone security, and it only guarantees security under sequential composition. And the more modern notion of security allows the environment to interactively distinguish, to send interactive challenges and get messages from the adversary. And this is called universal composability, universally composable security, and it guarantees that security holds even when executed concurrently or in an arbitrary execution environment. So most natural protocols in the information theoretic setting are automatically secure in this sense. In the computational setting, there are many relevant questions, but it's typically the case that practical protocols can also be made to satisfy the stronger definition with a small overhead. Good. So there are many, many definition variants, but the results in the area are not that sensitive to the specific version of MPC. There are a small number of standard models and there are general connections between the models. I should just say that if you want to fully specify an MPC model, you should say, or an MPC problem, you should say what is the functionality, which function you want to compute. You can have these flavors, deterministic versus randomized. For instance, the first example I gave of mapping secret shared input to secret shared output is a randomized functionality because it adds fresh randomness to reshare the output between the servers. This was the example of searching whether I'm healthy. I should see a doctor. An important point is that the question which functionalities are safe to compute is out of scope for MPC. So in MPC, our goal is just to compute the functionality as if getting the same security that we would get if we could employ a trusted party. The questions which functionality are safe or advisable to compute are very important questions and are studied by other disciplines, in past and future programs of Simons. There are many variations of the network model, adversary, security type, and so on that I will skip. Let me give you a flavor of how we saw one very specific example of computing the sum. Let me give you a flavor of how to compute every function. Right, going from sum to every function seems difficult, and we'll start by doing it in a simpler model, and then we will see how to extend it. Okay, so the model I'm considering now is two parties, Alice and Bob. The adversary is passive, which means that everybody follows the protocol and just tries to infer more information. We're talking about perfect security, so nothing computational here. And the only way in which I will be cheating is that I will allow some trusted offline dealer to give to Alice and Bob some correlated randomness. Okay, so the dealer will pick correlated randomness from some carefully chosen distribution, and this correlated randomness will allow Alice and Bob to compute every function of their inputs. You can think of it as the MPC analog of a one-time pad for encryption. Right? There is a dealer that instead of giving identical randomness to two parties, which suffices for encryption, it now gives correlated randomness to the two parties. Okay, so the protocol goes in the following way. Again, first, the model spelled out. There is a trusted dealer. Before the inputs are known, the dealer gives the parties correlated randomness RA, RB from some joint distribution. Now, once the inputs X for Alice and Y for Bob are known, Alice and Bob interact. And in the end of the interaction, they should each learn the output of some function, arbitrary function f, on their inputs without learning anything about the other input. Okay, that's the goal. Any questions about the model? And everybody here follows the protocol. It's just about not revealing more information. Good, so the correlated randomness is picked in the following way. First, we take the truth table, right? So this truth table, you can think of it as a matrix. You know, with rows for x and columns for y. And this matrix will be shifted, cyclically shifted by random amounts dx to the right and dy to the bottom. Okay, so you pick random cyclic shift amounts of the truth table of the function and you just rotate it, right? So this is the rotation by dx to the right and dy to the bottom. Okay, what have we achieved by this rotation? Now the entry that we care about, the xy entry in this shifted table, it appears in a random location, purely random location, so it's okay to reveal this location in the shifted matrix. Okay, so we've generated this shifted truth table, and now what does this is something that the dealer does before the inputs are known, and now the dealer splits it into two shares using additive secret sharing, as we saw before. GA and GB add up to this shifted truth table. And Alice gets one share of the shifted truth table and her shift of the input, and Bob gets the same, the second share and his shift of the input. Okay, and now the protocol is very simple. It has two rounds of interaction. In the first round, each party just masks its real input with the corresponding shift amount. Okay, so Alice sends the right column in the shifted table. Alice sends the right column in the shifted table, and Bob sends the right row in the shifted table. Okay, and now because they have these additive shares of the shifted table, they can each send their share of the entry that was made public in the first round, and this only reveals, because we have this secret sharing of the shifted matrix, it only reveals the right entry. So it only reveals the output of the function, and the fact that the position that we read from the shifted table is public does not hurt us because this position has been randomized. Okay, so it's a super simple protocol. It applies to every function with the caveat of employing a trusted dealer. So what's bad about this protocol? Well, it works if you can fit the truth table of the function into the memory, but if you look at typical applications of MPC, the truth tables will be huge, so it's not practical in these cases. And so this raises the question if we can apply a similar protocol in the same model that uses less randomness. It turns out that this is not difficult. I will not show this for lack of time, but let me just say that if you represent your function by a circuit, Boolean or arithmetic circuit, you can evaluate it using both communication and dealer randomness whose size is comparable to the size of the secret, of the circuit. Okay? You can think of it as applying a protocol similar to the truth table protocol for every gate, where this protocol reveals the mask value of this gate and you do it gate by gate from the inputs to the outputs. Okay, so this is something coming up maybe in my next talk, not here. I will not show the details, but let me just say something else which is quite interesting. Can you get a protocol with much less randomness for every function f? So if you look at the worst function or a random function, the minimal circuit size is almost 2 to the n, right? Let's denote by k the input length of the function. So the circuit size of most functions is roughly 2 to the k over k, so it's exponential. Okay, so the solution that is based on circuits will not go below exponential randomness. And it turns out that we can do better. This is the best we know. It's like instead of 2 to the k, it's 2 to the square root of k, so it's a super polynomial improvement. And the question, we have pathetic lower bounds, so there is a huge gap between the upper bounds and lower bounds, and these questions are not strictly equivalent, but they seem morally equivalent. There are two-way relations with well-studied questions in complexity theory related to locally decodable codes. So morally speaking, the answer to this question of how much randomness do you need should be equivalent to the question of what is the minimal length of a three query locally decodable code, for those who know. Okay, so this is an example where very natural question that talk only about information turn out to be almost equivalent, there is some caveat here, to questions that look very different and were studied by other communities. Good, so there is a very nice approach of generalizing this truth table solution for circuits over general gates, and it's related to a notion called function secret sharing that I will talk about in the theory lunch on Wednesday, so those who are interested can come to the talk on Wednesday. Okay, so I would like to say that this protocol, if we still allow a trusted dealer, it's very, very attractive. If you look at Boolean or arithmetic circuit, and you're considering execution of this protocol over fast communication network, it's almost like computing the function in the clear. So if you look at the circuit-based version of this protocol, which I haven't fully shown, but you can trust me, that the amount of computation performed by each party in the online phase is the same up to a small constant in terms of number of atomic operations, Boolean or arithmetic, to an insecure evaluation of the function. And indeed, this type of protocols serves as a basis for practical protocols that work quite well in practice. And the only question that remains here is, what about the dealer? Well, there are several answers to the question. The first is to emulate the generation of the correlated randomness via an MPC protocol. Now it seems circular, right? We want to build MPC, and now I'm telling you to implement this sampling using MPC. But it turns out that this is a much easier MPC task for two reasons. First of all, it can be done offline before the inputs are known, so the efficiency of this protocol matters less. Second, the functionality of generating the correlated randomness is much easier than the functionality that we use this correlated randomness to compute. That's the second reason that makes it easier. And third, again, you'll hear about it on Wednesday, but we have some new techniques for making this generation, essentially compressing the amount of communication that was required by classical methods to do this generation of correlated randomness. So now we have good ways that are both practical and theoretically appealing to generate correlated randomness securely with small amount of communication. Okay, and finally, we can get rid of the dealer, of course. And let me just show you the simple way to do it. It's very easy. So first, let's start by thinking of the dealer as a party who has an input. So now I want to build a 3PC protocol with no trusted dealer, where each party has an input, and I want security against a single party. What do I do? So now we have Alice with X, Bob with Y, Carol with Z. We let Z act both as a dealer that generates correlated randomness, and also for the previous protocol, and also Carol will split her input using secret sharing between Alice and Bob. So now if we modify the functionality, the two-party functionality, so that it first adds the two shares of the input of Carol and then applies the original F, then we've reduced this 3PC problem, three-party computation, to the two-party computation problem, and we have security against a single party. Okay, so this gives us an information theoretic protocol for three parties, assuming at most one is corrupted. And I said in the beginning that we can deal with any number of parties as long as we have an honest majority. So how do you go from three parties to more parties? This is a trick that I guess is applied in different contexts, but there is a general way of bootstrapping. This is a joint work with Ron and others that allows us to recursively emulate a party in a three-party protocol by a protocol, right? So if you do a log depth tree of substitutions where you replace the role of a party by a protocol. Think of the trustee as a party as a trusted party, and now replace this trusted party by a three-party protocol and repeat it log times. Log ensures that complexity still blows up only polynomially. And now you do some random assignment of parties, you will get something similar to the feasibility results for honest majority MPC with polynomial communication. don't try this at home. It's not a good method. We have much better direct methods, and I'm running out of time, so I will not explain them. But this is how the efficient protocols look like. They use Shamir secret sharing. These are the protocols in the honest majority setting. And we have different protocols for no honest majority, and I will skip to. And finally, this is how it all started. This is Yao's original protocol that uses this beautiful concept of garbled circuits. And I should say, referring to Berkeley here, that there's a very surprising extension of garbled circuits, I'm trying to get to it, to garbled protocols. This is a technique introduced by Sanjam and Akshay and others, that allows us to generally collapse rounds in interactive protocols. So we saw protocols that use many rounds of communication. You have a technique, a general technique, that allows us to compress the number of rounds to two rounds under a mild computational assumption. So this essentially settles most open questions about the round complexity of MPC, which were open for many years. Okay, let me talk about just mentioning there is a powerful general tool, a breakthrough from 2009, the first construction of fully homomorphic encryption that had a major impact on the communication complexity of MPC, essentially almost closing the gap between the communication complexity of computing a function without security and the communication complexity of securely computing a function. I guess I should end. Okay, so I should say that there is this alternative hardware-based solution. It's been subject to recent attacks, and perhaps in the future will tell which approach will win, but perhaps the right answer is to combine MPC and trusted hardware. You can use MPC techniques to make hardware more secure in the same sense that you use error correcting codes inside hardware. You can also use simple MPC. And you can put MPC on top of trusted hardware, getting some kind of best of both worlds security. Okay, there are many open questions, feasibility, communication, and so on. Since I'm running out of time, I will leave it offline to anyone who is interested, unless I have a couple of more minutes, but I guess that I don't. What? Yeah. What? We're out of time. Okay, so thank you all for your attention. So I believe that that in principle MPC can be used and will be practical for these type of problems. I'm not, as I said in the beginning, I'm not an authority on real world issues, so I can only hope that that MPC will actually help society using federated learning or by other means. But yeah, I'm happy to talk about it, to hear more about the details of this.
All right, let's thank you again.